Hi.
Hi, doctor, how are you?
I'm fine. Can you hear me properly?
I can hear you properly, yes. Okay, let me adjust this correctly so that. Perfect. Can you hear me as well?
Yes, very well.
Very nice. It's so lovely to see you again, doctor.
Thank
And
you.
I'd like to welcome all our viewers to the Charak Aadya, an initiative of Charak Pharma to empower and educate women. Of course, is Dr. Amai Purandare, a very well-known gynecologist. It's so lovely to have you here, doctor.
Yeah, same here, Vidya. Very nice to see you in these tough times, and always smiling, always positive, and always energetic with all your yoga poses, etc. on Instagram. I think it keeps us very, very motivated to lead a very active and a very, very positive lifestyle.
How
So
lovely.
I
Thank
think thanks. Yeah, thanks so much for inviting me on this very important topic, because I think there are a lot of myths and controversies about menopause. So it's good that we are talking about this very important topic.
I agree completely. So we are going to be talking about menopause today. So first and foremost, what is menopause?
Okay, so first of all, I'd like to clarify with everybody that menopause is a natural event in a woman's life. It's not something abnormal. It's not something as a disease event or anything like that. Just as everything ages in the world, so does human beings. In a woman's life, there are different roles she plays, from being a daughter, then being a student as an adolescent, then being a married woman, then being a mother, then being a mother-in-law, okay, and then spending the elderly part of her life, which is menopause. But medically speaking, menopause is when the female hormones start declining, and these female hormones are produced by the ovaries. There are two ovaries that every woman has naturally. It does produce the female hormones. And with age, these hormones start declining because the ovary starts declining in function, and that leads to menopause.
Okay, so there's nothing to be worried about menopause, basically. It's just such a natural phenomenon of life for women. So what do you think, when should one expect it? What should be the exact age for a woman to be in her menopause?
So just like we have a chronological clock, which tells us the time, which tells us our birthday every year. So we have a biological clock as well, which our body tissues and cells have a time span. And so menopause is a biology runs by a biological clock. But if you go by various studies, each country has different ages of menopause. If
What?
you see if you see US, their age of menopause is about 51, 52 years. Indian studies have shown a wide variation, ranging from as early as the late 40, I mean the early part of the 40s, 43, 44, to the 50s. But we are slightly at an earlier age as compared to the US. There could be many reasons for this. Okay, there could be many reasons, but the simplest way to explain is genetic susceptibility. So it's a racial thing. In addition to that, it could depend on your education, on your nutrition, on the presence of various diseases. Now, environment plays a very important role. So it's a multifactorial thing. But it's very simple to remember. By the time you cross 50, okay, you are starting to enter menopause, usually.
Okay, so I mean, it is not a good thing or a bad thing to have it a little before or a little later, isn't it?
No, you can't really change when you will have it. But if you have it very early, that is in your early 40s or even before that, we call it premature menopause. And that could be a problem of concern because you know that women are now having babies at later ages because careers, settling down, etc. So there it could be a problem. But natural menopause sets in around between 45 to 50 years of age. It could go beyond 50 also in a few ladies, so need not worry. As I told you.
Now, my mom had it at 45.
Yeah, so it you need not worry. I told you the biological clock will decide when you will get menopause. Just accept it. It is a part of your life.
Right.
Take it in your stride and let's move ahead.
But do you think in this day and age, the menopause is kind of coming a little before time for women just generally because of the high stress?
Yes. Yes, I told you that it's to deal with our stresses. It's to deal with our lifestyle. It's to deal with our nutrition and it's to deal with our environment. So these four concerns as a part of human evolution have resulted in a change of menopause. It's the same with respect to menarche. Girls are having their first period much earlier than a few generations ago. Again, it's to do with these factors as well.
Absolutely. So then what actually really happens in menopause and what are the symptoms that one has to look for?
So let's take the cardinal event as menopause. Anything before that is called as premenopause. Anything after that is called as postmenopause. Okay? So the cardinal event or the index event is menopause. Now you will hear a lot about this word called as perimenopause. So it's things around the menopause. Okay? So a few years before menopause and a few years after menopause. That's the time when the transition occurs. That's the time which you need to take things in your stride. That's the time when changes are going to occur in your body, in your mind, okay, in your mood, everything. So in your hormones as well.
Out.
Yeah, I didn't get you with that.
What kind of changes are we talking about?
Yeah, so there are many changes. Every organ in the body has a change. I told you, it's because the cells are aging now. So skin starts wrinkling, the mind becomes a little slow, okay? The bones become a little weak, the muscles begin to undergo atrophy, the heart begins to undergo changes, the uterus obviously starts becoming smaller in size, menses stop, the ovaries start shrinking. So everything is changing, okay? It's a part and parcel of life. It's a phase of life. We need to accept it.
Wow. So what about perimenopause? What you said that the term perimenopause is a little before and a little after the actual event. So what is that duration? A year, 2 years? What is?
Yeah. So natural menopause is a slow process. It's a transition. It's not that overnight you will have menopause. Okay, it's a transition process. It takes a few years. So this year, few years is called as menopausal transition. Some others use the word as climacteric, but it's too much of a dramatic word, so I won't use it. Okay, so it's a gradual transition, takes about 3 to 5 years to occur, and slowly sets in. It's not an overnight thing. It would set in drastically in a few months if for surgical reasons or for any other reason that the ovaries suddenly shut down, then maybe it could get accelerated, but still there is enough reserve in the body to ensure that it occurs slowly in a smooth transition.
And how do you diagnose this? How do you diagnose a perimenopause or a menopause for that matter?
Yeah, so there are four important ways that you can diagnose it. So I'll tell you starting from the simple way, the most simplest way is when periods stop for a year or so, when 12 consecutive periods stop. So we say that, yeah, menopause has set in. She's gone into the phase of postmenopause. Okay. If you go to see, I told you that the hormones are not produced by the ovary. So as a result of which estrogen, which is the female hormone, its levels drop. So there's a fall in estrogen if I were to take the woman's blood, and the body is trying to initiate production of estrogen. So another hormone called as FSH, which is follicle stimulating hormone, increases. It's a compensatory phenomenon. In addition to that, also there are things like the bones become weaker, the mood changes, the skin begins to wrinkle, the hair begins to age, and all these things. So there is what is called as clinical menopause, and there is something called as biochemical menopause, that means lab-related menopause.
What is that?
That is when you do a lab test and it tells you that the hormones are decreased, it means that you have got a lab-diagnosed menopause.
Okay, so just to get this right in my head, you need to have 12 clear months of no period, and then you have had menopause.
You are confirmed to have menopause.
So in perimenopause, do your your periods there or not there?
Yeah, good question. Good question. That's the time. That's what most of our viewers are going to ask us today. As I told you, it's a transition. Things are slowing down. So obviously the cyclicity of periods is going to get disturbed. It's going to be slow. It's going to be irregular. It's going to be erratic. Okay. There could be periods which come after 3 months, 6 months. Sometimes they come more often, say in a month's time. So that period is a period of little irregularity. It's because the hormonal imbalance has set in. It's a period when...
Sorry. And you think the period could be heavy or it should be light or it should be either?
No, it slowly starts reducing in quantity and it becomes less often frequent. It sort of occurs at longer intervals of time.
Oh, okay. So basically, that's your period of perimenopause, right? Where your periods are erratic and they may come, they may not come, they may come every month a little bit, they may come after 2 months, 5 months.
So,
at some point, you will have a 1 year clear gap, and that means you are, you are in menopause. And then starts post. Correct. So is there a treatment for the symptoms that one gets? I mean, I don't know. Skin and falling hair, maybe do yoga.
So I think the first symptom that usually patients come to us as gynecologists are what is called as hot flashes, or hot flushes. So this is because of vasomotor imbalance. I'm sorry, I'm using too much of scientific jargon, but it's because estrogen deprivation has occurred. And as a result of which certain neurochemicals get released, which cause parts of the body, which are supplied, the skin, which is supplied by blood vessels, these blood vessels dilate. So there is warmth. So the body feels warm. You feel as if you're in a furnace. You start sweating. Okay. You can't sleep because this occurs more in the night. And this is called as hot flashes. It's one of the most dramatic symptoms of menopause, and this is when patients come to us. First is menstrual irregularity, and second is hot flashes.
Okay, so these obviously happen during perimenopause and menopause as well.
Yes.
And then post your menopause, it stops.
It sort of becomes less frequent and then fizzles away. The body copes up. The strong-minded ladies tackle it, take it in their stride, and it just goes up.
And just to find out, I mean, how long does that last? I mean, you said that the whole period could last about 5 years. So one would get hot flushes for that many years, you think? Or
no, you don't get it for that many years, but it can be for a few months. And by the time the body has certain compensatory mechanisms by which it settles down.
Right.
Now, when things don't settle down and you are too much distressed with these problems and you seek medical advice, then the doctor can give you certain medications by which this hormonal imbalance can get corrected. That means the doctor could give you estrogen because all this is triggered off because of estrogen deprivation. and could give certain other medications which will act on the neurotransmitters and will correct the problem that is occurring.
Right.
But like you said, Vidya, the best way to treat this is to tone down your mind, because finally it is the neurochemicals which are getting released. So if you have good techniques like yoga, meditation, etc., positive thinking, this will settle down.
So basically, then what is the lifestyle change that one must do to actually relieve ourselves of these symptoms that can affect us so much?
Okay, so the first and the most important thing, I think, to conquer any health related issue is to accept it. Okay, don't be in a state of opposition. Be in a state of acceptance and then find or troubleshoot the solution. So you take it into your stride, know that, tell yourself that this is a part of my normal process, and then have a healthy lifestyle, exercise properly, do yoga, do meditation, talk positively, don't crib about it at all times. I know it's a difficult time, okay? Seek your doctor's advice if you think that you can't cope up with it. Take the medications properly and things will settle down.
So you actually think, I mean, I'm a complete believer of this, that you can actually manifest whatever you want in your life. And I think that's how I kind of lead my life, in a way to think that you can always look at a glass and say either it's half empty or half full. And because it's such a natural phenomenon, I don't think anybody should think of it as anything else. And the only way to sort of overcome issues as such, symptoms as such, is a positive thinking, affirmation every day, and a little bit of yoga, meditation, breathing. I think pranayama plays such an important part in something.
So since you brought in the topic of pranayama is an excellent medical intervention, okay, for cardiorespiratory health.
Yes.
It ensures that your lung passages have the adequate amount of oxygenation, and this oxygen is absolutely essential for normal functioning of every cell in our body.
Yeah.
Right? We are seeing the problems of lack of oxygenation as we see in COVID, how it causes a lot of issues. And therefore, pranayama is an excellent exercise, an excellent daily ritual, which will ensure that adequate oxygenation reaches all your parts. Now, oxygen is like the magic bullet for our body. You know, it is the gas which we breathe, which we live, and is essential for human existence. So
I mean,
therefore, if it reaches...
Without water for a few hours, for a few days, you can do without food for a few days. Try doing without oxygen for a few days or hours or minutes even, and we'll see, right?
Yes. Yeah. So therefore, it is very essential to do pranayama. Now, why is this so important in menopause? This is important in menopause because estrogen, the female hormone, is very protective towards the woman's heart. Okay? Like you all women say, we have very strong hearts. Okay? Right? Not in the movies, because time and again, a lot of serials and a lot of movie scripts run on how women's hearts are broken and what happens to them. But otherwise, estrogen is very, very protective towards the woman's heart. And that's why, Vidya, it's very important to know, prior to menopause, the chances of heart attack are greater in men as compared to women. So women are the stronger sex with stronger hearts. Okay? After menopause, when the estrogen levels fall, this protective effect of estrogen on the heart is obviously lost. And therefore, women also become at a greater risk for cardiovascular diseases, heart attacks, etc. So estrogen has a very important physiological, that means normal protective effect on the heart. Hence, we need to improve the heart's condition. We need to make it healthy. We need to maintain this health. Hence, this pranayama, breathing exercises, aerobics, etc. is absolutely essential.
Correct. So I think what a healthy lifestyle would constitute, according to me at least, would be doing some sort of breath work, which is pranayama, for your heart health as well, and also just for the breath, for the prana, for the oxygen, like you were talking about. Secondly, do a little meditation to just keep your mind and your body in that state of calm, so that it's not, because like you said, there are so many things that a woman is dealing with, and because it's age related anyways, we fear getting older. So even if it's natural, it's there's that always that thing, you know, there's, oh my God, sort of a thing. Plus, you don't want to lose your hair and lose your beautiful skin and start, you know, sagging skin and all of that. So I think it's very important to keep that sense of positivity and calmness, which can come via a meditation or two every day. And then, like you said, something aerobic as an exercise, or just maybe a yoga practice, or just walking would do that as well. Just to keep yourself, like they say, movement is...
So Vidya, I just want to tell you one important point about exercise. Like I told you, breathing is one important form of exercise. So also, and you understand it better than me, that core exercises are also very important, because as I told you, the bones become brittle, right, and the muscles undergo atrophy. Again, both of these are because of estrogen deprivation. Mind you, estrogen stimulates bone growth in a woman. Okay, and estrogen maintains muscle tone in a woman. So if both of this is going to be affected, so you need to do some form of core exercises, and like walking is one of the best core exercises, but even other forms of core exercises are also very, very useful. You don't need to overdo them, because otherwise you would land up with some kind of a muscle tear or a bone injury. You need to do it in moderation, but you need to do it in maintenance. That means you need to do it on a daily basis.
Right.
So diet and exercise in a disciplined manner is the key to good health in menopause.
So even if one walks for about 20 to 30 minutes every day, 5-6 times in a week, is more than enough, isn't it? I think that we must take out for ourselves, because it's your own self and your own body. If you don't give it love and time, who else will? Now, the next thing you actually just spoke about, which I want to talk about and go a little further in, is diet. So what are the do's and don'ts, maybe, or what is it that one must sort of keep in mind? For both of us, is there anything specific that one should have? Or, yeah.
So proteins are an absolute yes in this age group, because proteins, as you know, are bodybuilding substances. So a good high protein diet is absolutely essential. Obviously, junk food is no. Oily food is to be avoided, because again, it's bad for the heart, it's bad for the tissues, it's bad for the skin. Fruits are the best source of a well-balanced diet. You must take them. Water is absolutely essential, except in cases where there is a heart or a kidney issue. You need to then adjust it as per your doctor's advice. But overall, in a healthy individual, you can take this. There are few things which set in during this period, and that could be a late onset diabetes, hypertension, thyroid disorders, etc. So if any of these are present, they must be optimized. That means with your doctor's help, you need to keep them in control so that they don't cause damage, because you know excess sugar is bad. Anything in excess is bad. So all that is to be kept in mind. So
that menopause can cause these?
No, menopause doesn't cause these. Right. These occur at the time of menopause. Menopause is a physiological thing. It doesn't cause anything. If you don't have a healthy lifestyle and a healthy diet, the body will deviate towards disease. And that's when all these other non-communicable diseases like diabetes, blood pressure, thyroid, etc. set in. Another important thing at menopause is obesity. And that's why a healthy, active lifestyle is very essential. Obesity.
Why?
Because women slow down by then. Okay, you're not as active as you were in your 40s and 30s. You're taking it more easy. Maybe you've retired from your job, etc. And therefore, you need to ensure that your metabolism is equally active. And hence, when you said you have a well-defined daily schedule with good amount of exercise, with good amount of activity, keep your brain active, do crosswords, do Sudoku, it'll all lead to a good positive frame of mind.
I guess also keeping yourself occupied, I mean, in a good way, is also very important, because at this time most people sort of want to retire and things like that, which is also a good thing at some point. But like they say, idle mind is also a devil's workshop. If you have kids or grandkids, it's really nice to be occupied with them.
Spend quality time with them.
And this is something I even tell my friends, is to have an animal, say a dog or something, because I feel like they take the stress away completely. And it's happened in my life as well. You know, that a little puppy or a dog or somebody, I mean, the amount of love that you get, if you surround yourself by that much love, whether it's family, it's your friends, it's people around you, I think it just gets a little easier, because we are social beings and we need connection with each other eventually. Also, doctor, talking about these same things, are there any more complications that one should be aware of with menopause?
Yeah, so I don't want to be too scary and negative, so I'll tell you what the troubleshooting for the complications are. Okay, first of all, if you lead a healthy lifestyle, if you act in time, these complications don't occur in everybody. So the key to healthy life in menopause is prevention, is to act before disease sets in. And that's up to us. We need to be aware, we need to be conscious, and we need to go and seek medical advice in time on a regular basis. You're not going to the doctor because you have disease. You're going to the doctor to ensure that you're healthy. Okay? So you're not going there because you're somebody who's sick. You're going there because you want to maintain the same level of health even when you age. So some of the complications are osteoporosis. Osteoporosis means porous bones or brittle bones. I told you estrogen has a stimulant effect on bone mass and bone growth. Estrogen decreases, bones become weak. Therefore, a calcium-rich diet, calcium supplementation, vitamin D supplementation, and good exercise, maybe a little bit of weight-bearing exercise would also be useful, because you don't want osteoporosis to set in. Another important thing is with respect to your heart. I told you the heart may weaken, the lipids may go haywire, and therefore diet, exercise, disciplined daily schedule, proper medical guidance is essential in ensuring that your cardiometabolic health is retained. Endocrine issues like diabetes, thyroid need to be evaluated. There's another thing that I need to address, and that's again the myth about cancer. Remember that in menopausal ladies, the risk of cancer is little more than the normal, and therefore you need to get yourself screened to ensure that you are not in the pre-cancerous state, or unfortunately cancer has set in. There are simple tests that you need to do. Cervical cancer, you do the pap smear test. It's a non-invasive test. You just need to go to your gynecologist and it will be done in a few minutes. If the pap smear is normal on 3 occasions at regular intervals of a year, the lifetime risk of cervical cancer is almost negligible, but you need to do it on a regular basis. The second is breast cancer. So we usually recommend any lady more than 45 years of age should have a mammogram at least every yearly, if not every 3 yearly. Yearly in those who are at a higher risk, maybe they have family history of breast cancer, or they have had other cancers in the body, etc. The third is about other cancers, for example, colorectal cancer, etc. Again, higher in this age group. So if you go to your doctor and the doctor does these screening tests, they will be looked at, even ovarian cancer and uterine cancer. So overall, it's because of it's more prevalent in this higher age group. So the best way to tackle is to screen for it.
So basically, at your perimenopausal period, one should start screening oneself every single year for all of these, like you said, because prevention is obviously better than cure. So this is something that's extremely, I mean, because it's on the rise these days, it's also very, very important for us to take note of this and do something about it. Absolutely. What about traditional medicines? Are there any that can be easing the symptoms of menopause?
So I'm a strong advocate of natural medicine. Because if you go to see, nature is the best healer, okay? And nature is the best medicine, okay? So if you have substances which are a part of our normal diet, and if we consume them in the purest way, obviously the body is going to benefit from it. But just to enumerate, calcium, vitamin D, antioxidants, which retard this aging process, are important in menopausal ladies. I strongly believe in giving supplementation to menopausal ladies because it is a state of deficiency. It is a state of decline. And if you give dietary supplementation, all these deficiencies will get corrected.
What
so calcium,
the calcium.
Yeah. Calcium, vitamin D, estrogen deficiency. So some of the natural ways by which you can supplement this is to take soy protein, soy in diet. Okay. Then ashwagandha is another one which Ayurveda acharyas use. Okay. Nutraceuticals like green tea and even grape seed are very good. Now, I know it's difficult to get all these things together on a daily basis. Yes, yes.
Yeah, it's yummy. I like it. Yeah.
Yeah, but it's difficult to get all this together on a daily basis.
Right.
So if we could have some supplement which gives you this in a ready-made manner, okay, in the right proportion, with the purity, with no side effects, that would be the best way to achieve or, you know, to have it. To have a wholesome diet. And we are thankful to Charak, who are one of the leaders in such nutraceutical products. In fact, they have a legacy of more than 75 years providing genuine Ayurvedic medicines to our country and even beyond our country. And they have something called as Eva Nova Nutra. It's a nutraceutical product which contains all these formulations in the purest form. So it can be taken without any side effects. Now, I am an allopathic doctor. So let me tell you a little bit about allopathic medicine as well.
Right.
You have estrogen therapy, but estrogens do cause some harm if they are not taken in the right dose or if they are not moderated properly or monitored properly. It has been shown that when women in the West received them, you know, as a prophylactic thing without any symptoms, they were just put on estrogen. They increase the risk of breast cancer. They increase the risk of uterine cancer. They increase the risk of stroke and heart attack. So therefore, our modern medicine tells us only if a lady is needing it and cannot be treated with any other natural method or dietary method, only symptomatic ladies should be given it who are going to be compliant and are going to come to your clinic at regular intervals ranging from 3 months, 6 months, etc. Then only give this hormone replacement therapy.
Wow.
So we are extremely judicious when we start this. Okay. It is the correct way to go about as per modern medicine. And that's why the importance of something what you said in the natural universe, if we are able to substitute, it would be definitely beneficial and it would be risk-free.
Right. So basically, yeah, I mean, I'm all about natural living and, you know, eating and imbibing nature. Like you said, we kept talking about vitamin D as well. I mean, I think most of us these days don't even go out and get any sun. We live in AC, work in AC offices, we drive in AC cars. So it's very... I mean, this is something that is offered to us on a platter and we're still not willing to take it. So then it gets a little, I mean, you just wonder that, you know, how will you not, if you want life to be a part of you, then you've got to take in the nature, because that's where life is, you know, because that's where life is coming from, I think, isn't it? Well, thank you so much, Doctor. I think we've had a wonderful conversation.
Before we end, I'd like to give you 10 tips, which I call the 10 mantras to menopause. Okay. Number one, eat a good diet, which is rich in proteins, which is free of fats, and avoid junk food. Sleep well, meditate, or do some form of yoga on a daily basis. Keep yourself involved. Be emotionally attached to your family members. Don't detach from them. Be involved with them. Numbers, this thing, I know it's going to be a career change, but deviate your mind into some hobby, maybe reading, maybe spirituality, maybe painting, maybe just knitting or sewing. These small things will give you pleasure. Take supplements as per your doctor's advice. Go and meet your doctor. He's your friendly neighborhood person. You don't need to fear him, but you need to go and seek his advice and ensure that he screens for any complications. Last but not the least, avoid any hormones unless they are absolutely necessary. And get your tests on a regular basis. Finally, accept menopause as a natural process. If you accept it, you will age gracefully and you will have happy times, prosperous times, contented times during menopause.
Absolutely. I'll just add one more thing that I feel like is a solution to literally everything for me, and that is connect with nature. Nature could be your plants, could be animals, could be the sun, could be the sea, could be a forest. I think everything in nature is here to heal us, and we have just lost that connection. So I feel like we say eat natural, keep it natural, but I think the connection with nature is what I feel, especially for us city, we only see concrete all around us. So I feel like connection with nature is very, very important, at least for me. And I think for healing.
On a lighter note, remember, just like there is female menopause, there is also male menopause. Okay?
Yeah, really? I thought we were going through it all on ourselves. Please tell us about what that is. I've never known that happens.
Yeah, you've been reading about it, that so many men have midlife crisis. So they call it crisis, but the women, they never call it crisis. Okay, they accept it and they move ahead. So that's the way that you need to treat menopause.
Thank you. That was so sweet, actually. I know. Yeah. So I'm going to take a few questions and see if you've got anything interesting. If you have anything interesting at your end, then please tell me something from your side as well. Oh, you know, somebody is asking about, hi doctor, I'm 19 years old and I suffer from some kind of pain after my period. What is it? Now, doctor is coming back again next Friday and he will be answering all your questions and giving you solutions for all period problems. So do join us again on next Friday. Dr. Purandare will be very happy to address any of these questions.
Surely.
And if there's anything about, oh, I lost my mother to ovarian cancer. Oh, so sorry, Juniper. If there are any questions on your side, we'd love to take those.
Yeah,
as well.
So there is one question that I see, and it's talking about weight gain in menopause. So, like I said, there is some amount of physiological weight gain. It sets in around the time of menopause. The causes are many, but important things which you can control are your activity. If you keep your metabolic rate at the same level which it was prior to menopause, the excessive calories will not get deposited as fat. So keep yourself active. In ensure that your diet is a balance. It's a moderated diet. It's not excess in fats, etc., or excess too many sweets. And look out for any other problems which might be leading to this resistant increase in weight. For example, a thyroid issue which has crept in, or maybe some hormonal imbalance which has crept in, etc. Or it could be an age-related kidney issue. So if you are suspecting some other issue as well, seek a doctor's advice. But the simplest way would be to keep yourself active and the weight will get lost.
But doctor, do you think that because menopause is setting in, much difficult to have that same metabolic rate as you would have before? It would be a harder challenge, isn't it? So maybe
so
it's harder to sort of bring yourself back to that. And is it, do you also think that weight around the belly happens more during menopause? Is there a reason for it?
Yes, again, that is because the fat deposits in those areas, specifically around the time of menopause in women. Those are more fat depositing areas. Okay. All of us have areas where the fat likes to get deposited. It has a preponderance to deposit in those areas. And that's why if you keep yourself, you raised a very important point that, you know, how can you expect an elderly lady to do the same workout that probably you are doing or maybe a teenager is doing? Yes, and therefore you have to do it in moderation, but you have to do it in a day on a daily basis. So cumulatively, your body gets into that that phase.
Right. Also, somebody is asking how much should one walk on a daily basis?
Again, it depends from person to person. Don't overdo things because your bones might get and your joints might get affected if you overdo things. You know, osteoarthritis and all these other issues could come in. So a safe thing would be half an hour of walk, maybe in the morning, half an hour of walk, maybe in the evening, or an hours of walk, maybe once a day. It has to be a gentle walk. It can't be a very brisk walk. It has to be, because slow and steady always wins the race.
But if one is in a habit of doing like a intense gym workout or any sort of workout like that, then they obviously can continue with what they are doing, isn't it?
Yes, because their body is used to that kind of workout.
Right.
I'm talking about the general people who will not, who don't go to the gym, okay, who are not as rigorous like you are, okay, on a daily basis with their workout. It's for general people, so they should have their moderated walk, about half an hour a day. That would be enough. Twice a day would be better. Okay, don't overdo things.
Correct. Also, this is by a lady and she wants to know, can women still have actual healthy relationship, intimate relationships post menopause as well?
Yes, it's a good question. Post menopause, like all the organs in the body, the reproductive organs also undergo atrophy. And therefore, there is vaginal dryness, okay? Because lubrication is reduced. Estrogen causes lubrication in the vagina. So women do complain of dryness. They do complain of discharge. But there are certain preparations, like Charak comes up with a gel called as Femiplex, okay? It's a gel which women can use if they experience dryness, and it will help in lubrication. It's a natural gel, so it doesn't have any side effects as such. Keeping relations is acceptable at that age, but you need to be careful whether you're having any kind of bleeding, any kind of burning, etc. So don't be averse to it, but you could use these medications as well.
Well, I think we have covered. Oh, this is another sweet little message. Congratulations for explaining in a very candid and clear way. Excellent, and liked it very much. And this is by Dr. Vidyadhar Ranade from Pune. And he's also thanking me for asking very nice questions and thanking Charak Pharma as well. So on that lovely note, I think we can call it a day.
Yeah. And so the last word is that all your fans who have logged in today, please get yourself vaccinated, especially those nearing menopause. There is no relation of menses with vaccine. There is no relation of menopause with vaccine. Vaccine is found to be life-saving in our fight against the pandemic. We want to get out of this as quickly as possible. So get motivated to get vaccinated as quickly as possible. And in the meantime, ensure that you have the mask at all times, you wash your hands properly at all times, and you maintain social distancing as per the rules and regulations of the government. But don't go away from vaccines. Vaccines are going to help you get out of the pandemic.
Very well said, Doctor. Thank you once again for joining us and enlightening us about this very natural process of half the human beings on this planet. It was lovely to chat with you. And to all our viewers, do join Dr. Purandare back again on next Friday, because he's going to be talking about issues and solutions regarding any period issues that any one of you may have.
Vidya, can I have a question to you? Because you've been asking me. So,
as beautifully as you have been, but of course you may ask.
So Vidya, what's new from Vidya Malavde as far as the screen is concerned?
I have a very good news. Well, you know, it's been wonderful. Somehow, I feel a little sad, guilty actually, to say that the last year and this year has been phenomenal in terms of my career, because I know what has been going around, in our world. But having said that, I've had 4-5 releases on the web series' OTT platforms. Mismatch released last year, which has done phenomenally well. The season 1 on Mismatch, of Mismatch on Netflix. I will be starting season 2 very shortly. I'm going to be reading the script in just 3 days from now, and I'm extremely excited about it. And yesterday I finished with the project called Bamini and Boys season 2. So it is a very departure after 40 days of shooting with my crew. It was eventually to say goodbye yesterday. And yes, Bamini and Boys season 1 is on Hotstar and it's done very well. So I'm very happy. You should look forward to season 2. And today I've just come back actually from amazing meeting and a look test. Half of my makeup and hair and the bindi is from the look test that I've done for an incredibly amazing filmmaker, and we're going to be starting shooting this project next week. So I can't talk more about it because I would like them to talk about it and then I can speak about it. But this is just, I think, I just feel truly grateful to be a part of such esteemed people's vision of creating some beautiful work in terms of cinema. And I always say, you know, that if you have a dream, you've got to really nurture it. Because for me, it has not come easy. This is my 19th year in the film industry, and it's only after 18 years that I've actually seen success. I mean, I did see it with Chak De, and that was roaring success, I must say. But after that, eventually, I think, because the markets fell or whatever happened to 2000, around that time, it was just a lull for so long. And it's very, very easy to get depressed and to start going into a negative spiral. But the only thing that kept me going till date, and to actually nurture that dream and say that, you know, there will be another day of sunshine, and I will give my best when that comes, and I will work towards that best every single day. So I think if you have a dream, you've got to nurture it, and you have to work and take that baby step every day, just a little bit, so that you get closer to your dream. And that is the only way to manifest and achieve what you want. Nothing comes without discipline, dedication, and consistency. Absolutely nothing.
Yeah. Thank you, Vidya, for those words. I think they are very inspiring to all our viewers today. Just one more important thing that I'd like to touch. Remember, there are two aspects of beauty, according to me. One is an inner beauty and one is an outer beauty. If you are beautiful in your inner self, you will manifest as beautiful in your outer self. And therefore, in menopause also, we look at, oh, will it cause me wrinkles? Will I lose my hair? Will my hair become white, etc.? You don't. Your inner beauty will take care of everything else. You don't need to do those fancy cosmetic enhancements, etc. Do them if you wish to, if it really matters to you. But otherwise, if you use our natural products, if you have use our natural supplements, eat good diets, all the antioxidants will take care of all your inner health, inner beauty, which will manifest as outer beauty. We don't need all those other things because inner beauty is lifelong, outer beauty may be temporary.
That's true. Thank you so much for those beautiful words of wisdom, Doctor. It was really lovely chatting with you. And I think I'll definitely call on you at some point and have a chat as well. That would be wonderful. Thank you so, so much for this.
Yeah, and from both of us, I think we need to thank Charak because they've done a very good thing by launching this platform of Aadhya. It's going to help many a woman of India to uplift their health, to reach a level of wellness.
I know, to empower them with beauty inside and out. So thank you so much, Charak. Charak Pharma, Charak Aadhya, for bringing us together and on this live. And our viewers as well for us and asking us these precious questions. Thank you so much for coming back.
Thank you so much. It's been a pleasure.